Okay, tell me you're ready. Good morning. Thank you for coming to the seminars on essential emergency care in Cambodia. On behalf of myself, Dr. Matt Strehlow, and Stanford University, we welcome you and want to thank you for having us. So let's get started. And what our first lecture is going to be is recognition of the critically ill patient.
បាទអញ្ចឹងមេរៀនដំបូងរបស់យើងនេះគឺតកតងជាមួយនឹងការស្គាល់ជំងឺធ្ងន
់ Let's start by asking a question. We have two patients. One is a young man with chest pain. The other is a man a little bit older, 50 years old, with chest pain. Which of these patients are you going to see first?Which is the priority, if that is all you know about them?
បាទអញ្ចឹងយើងចាប់ផ្ដើមដោយសារសំណួរទី1របស់យើងគឺយើងមានជំងឺ2ចូលនៅក្នុងកន្លែងសង្គ្រោះបន្ទាន់របស់យើងបាទម្នាក់ហ្នឹងគឺគាត់អាយុប្រហែលជា30ឆ្នាំហើយគាត់មកបញ្ហាដោយសារគាត់ឈឺទ្រូងហើយម្នាក់ទៀតអាយុ50ឆ្នាំគាត់មកដោយសារបញ្ហាឈឺទ្រូងដូចគ្នាតើយើងគិតថាយើងគួរតែមើលជំងឺមួយណាមុន
Raise your hand if you would say the 30-year-old first.
បាទយើងសូមលើកដៃបើសិនជាគិតថាយើងមើលអ្នកជំងឺដែលមានអាយុ30ឆ្នាំមុន.
Raise your hand if you would see the 50-year-old first.
Okay, បើសិនគិតថាអ្នកជំងឺអាយុ50ឆ្នាំគួរតែមើលមុនសូមលើកដៃ.
Raise your hand if you don't need the translation.
បាទសូមលើកដៃបើអត់ត្រូវការអ្នកបកប្រែទេសូមខ្ញុំទៅអង្គុយវិញស្រួលបន្តិច
Now we've used our knowledge to decide which of those patients is more likely ill but we also use our eyes to look at the patient early on and you can tell is this patient sick or not sick
បាទអញ្ចឹងជាទូទៅយើងយកចំណេះវិជ្ជារបស់យើងដើម្បីព្យាបាលជំងឺប៉ុន្តែយើងច្រើនតែប្រើភ្នែករបស់យើងដើម្បីមើលថាតើជំងឺនឹងគាត់ឈឺធ្ងន់ឬមួយក៏អត់ធ្ងន់អញ្ចឹងមើលក្នុងវីដេអូរបស់យើងតើអ្នកជំងឺនឹងគាត់ឈឺធ្ងន់ឬក៏អត់ធ្ងន់ទេ
Raise your hand if you think sick Good because this patient obviously looks ill or sickSo what we're going to do today is we're going to talk about the emergency medicine approach to managing patients. What does that mean? We're going to then talk about a systematic approach where we do things one step at a time when we evaluate the patient. And then we're going to talk about why this system is good in an emergency situation.And what are some of the problems or challenges using that system that you should watch out for?
បាទអញ្ចឹងគោលបំណងរបស់មេរៀនរបស់យើងគឺទី1គឺយើងឲ្យនិយមន័យថាអ្វីជាវិទ្យាសាស្ត្រសង្គ្រោះបន្ទាន់បាទហើយមួយទៀតគឺយើងកំណត់ពីវិធីជាប្រព័ន្ធមួយដើម្បីវាតម្លៃអ្នកជំងឺដែលចូលមកហើយមានបញ្ហាធ្ងន់ធ្ងរហើយគោលបំណងចុងក្រោយរបស់យើងគឺឲ្យដឹងពីផលប្រយោជន៍ហើយនឹងការប្រឈមមុខគឺផលវិបាកក្នុងការប្រើវិទ្យាសាស្ត្រសង្គ្រោះបន្ទាន់ក្នុងការព្យាបាលជំងឺដែលមកមានបញ្ហាធ្ងន
់ So the traditional approach or the approach that you learn in medical school or nursing school is that you see the patient and you evaluate them. You then spend some time thinking about what the patient may have and what tests you want to get and then you make some decisions on how you are going to treat the patient
បាទអញ្ចឹងបើសិនជាយើងមើលវិធីសាស្ត្រទូទៅក្នុងការព្យាបាលជំងឺដែលយើងបានរៀននៅក្នុងសាលាពេទ្យក៏ដូចជាសាលានៅដែរគឺទី1កាលណាជំងឺចូលមកយើងចំណាយពេលវេលាដើម្បីវាតម្លៃជំងឺហ្នឹងបន្ទាប់មកទៀតយើងគិតថាយើងគួរតែធ្វើតេស្តអីខ្លះដើម្បីបញ្ជាក់រោគវិនិច្ឆ័យហើយបន្ទាប់មកទៀតតើយើងត្រូវព្យាបាលជំងឺហ្នឹងប្រភេទណា
This is different than the emergency medicine approach, which is where we do things simultaneously or at the same time. So we're going to evaluate or see the patient while we're thinking about what's going on. And if the patient is sick, we're going to do actions or interventions while we're evaluating the patient. And then we are going to re-evaluate the patient, think again about what could be going on, and then finally, after we've done that, we'll think about what things they need further and where they are best cared for.
Bà, chấm nai giờ cáp chia ba nơi không về chỉ xa sừng cột bẩn toán cứ cái nai chừng ngứa châu máu dương vi đầm lái và to mới thấy dương cất bà hái cứ dương chia ba không pe tại mũi khi này đầm lòng bà sinh gì nai chừng ngứa nâng miên pành nhà hán cứ dương chập đam vi đầm lái hay nâng chia ba và to mới tiết cứ dương thưa ca vi đầm lái quạt mà đón tiết dương cất pi vị thi chia ba bà hái nâng thưa ca chia ba hay và to pi nai chừng ngứa nâng quạt hiện miên sập hiệp lọ hái dương cất tha ta nai chừng ngứa nâng cô tại tơ chia ba này cả lại ná bà ưu tiên hỏi thở tới ICU rồi cái tới cái này nạp xe anh tiết hay nóng phai nạc ca nên cáp chị bà bà tọp tọp.
So the emergency medicine approach then, we're going to see them quickly. And because we're going to see them quickly or rapidly to get things started, we have to be systematic and do the same thing so we don't skip a very important step because we're moving quickly.
Bà anh chăng nếu không là chia sẻ group một toán, cứ dương thơ ca vi đầm lấy nè chữ ngữ nó ở bàn lươn. Hỏi dương chia ba có ở bàn lươn được không nè. Đối chứ đầm bây cầm ao dương play chấm hiên nà môi nông cao chia ba, cứ dương thơ ca thơ môi đà miên lạc nạ chia bọc bòn.
And what this means is that this can be uncomfortable for people that are and practitioners that are used to practicing in more traditional approach. Because you may not have the full diagnosis. You may not know exactly what is going on, but you already need to start caring for them and treating the patient with even less than all of the information that you want to get or will get in the future.
Bà pro nơi không cạn này sừng cột bẩn toán cứ dương nâng chập bà đan thôi cáp chia ba nhẹ chừng ngư tạm đón môn nâng dương thôi ban rô vị để chay để bật bạc cọt bà hai mô tiết pê khá dương từ tô ban po miên tại tách tôi bẩn non hai dương chập bà đan thôi cáp chia ba để sang nhẹ chừng ngư nâng cứ miên sập hiệp cứ thân đỏ dụ chỉ vật.
And also the patient that comes into the clinic, many times the assumption is the patient is healthy. And they have to show you if they are sick. And you are looking to see, oh, they are healthy. I will see if they are sick. But it's different in the emergency medicine approach. The patient in the emergency department is assumed to be sick. That your job is to make sure that they are not sick with something that is serious or life-threatening.
Bà, chấm nay nhạc chứng ngư đại châu cả lại sức lộ một toán cứ quạt máu cứ miên bảnh nhà hà. Hãy dương trời cất tha nhạc chứng ngư đại châu cả lại sức lộ một toán cứ chi nhạc chứng ngư đại chư thương ngôn tầng ọ. Rồi hộ đọc bê đại dương thơ tê thơ ấy bị trẻ thạc con nâng ọn miên bảnh nhà hà đại cổ khăn lạ chỉ vật.
So how do we do this approach? We start with our initial evaluation. And to do that, we do our general appearance where we just look at the patient. And then we assess their level of consciousness or how alert they are. And then we use the A, B, C, D, or airway, breathing, circulation, and disability. The disability being the neurologic assessment, brief neurologic assessment.
ទី 1 គឺយើងធ្វើការវាតម្លៃពីសភាពទូទៅរបស់អ្នកជំងឺនិងកម្រិតនៃការដឹងខ្លួនរបស់គាត់បន្តមកទៀតគឺយើងធ្វើការវាតម្លៃ A B C D គឺទី 1 គឺផ្លូវដង្ហើមផ្លូវខ្យល់របស់គាត់ហ្នឹងបាទការដកដង្ហើមរបស់គាត់ចលនាឈាមរត់របស់គាត់និងពិការភាពហើយដែលយើងនិយាយពិការភាពកន្លែងនេះគឺយើងសំដៅទៅលើការពិនិត្យតកតងជាមួយនឹងប្រព័ន្ធសរសៃប្រសាទរបស់អ្នកជំងឺ.
The key to doing something well is to do it 10,000 times. That is what they say. If you do something 10,000 times, you will be a master. So when you do this approach, you should do it on every patient, even if you are sure they are not sick. And that way you will do it 10,000 times, and when the patient is sick, you will be doing it without worrying about doing it correctly, because it comes easy, because you are a master.
បាទអញ្ចឹងដើម្បីឲ្យធ្វើការងារមួយបានល្អគឺយើងត្រូវការធ្វើវាបានច្រើនដងរហូតដល់ទៅ 10,000 ដងបាទអញ្ចឹងដើម្បីអនុវត្តបញ្ហានេះបានគឺគ្រប់ជំងឺដែលចូលមក emergency ទោះបីជាគាត់ឈឺធ្ងន់ឬមិនធ្ងន់ក៏ដោយគឺយើងចាប់ផ្ដើមការអនុវត្តគឺពិនិត្យ A B C D របស់គាត់ហ្នឹងកាលណាយើងធ្វើបានច្រើនដងជំងឺដែលចូលមកគឺយើងលែងភ័យថាមានបញ្ហាព្រោះយើងស្ទាត់ជាមួយនឹងការធ្វើការវាតម្លៃ A B C D ហ្នឹងហើយ
So as we do our initial evaluation, we also take early action if the patient is sick. So we don't wait for everything to be back before we start to intervene. So if you find an abnormality that is maybe severe on the initial evaluation, you intervene or treat the patient for that early.
បាទអញ្ចឹងនៅក្នុងការវាតម្លៃអ្នកជំងឺធ្ងន់នៅបន្ទប់ស្គ្រូបន្ទាន់គឺយើងធ្វើសកម្មភាពនោះឲ្យបានលឿនហើយប្រសិនបើយើងធ្វើការវាតម្លៃទៅឃើញថាអ្នកជំងឺនោះក៏មានបញ្ហាគឺយើងចាប់ផ្ដើមព្យាបាលភ្លាមភ្លាមដោយមិនចាំធ្វើការវាតម្លៃចប់នោះទេ
So let's go through those steps now of our initial evaluation and how I would go about it. The first thing I would do when I'm doing my general appearance and level of consciousness is to look at the patient and introduce myself and ask the patient their name.
បាទឥឡូវយើងមើលការអនុវត្តរបស់យើងគឺអ្វីដែលយើងធ្វើដំបូងគឺទី1កាលណាយើងចូលទៅជួបអ្នកជំងឺគឺយើងពិនិត្យមើលគាត់ហើយយើងណែនាំខ្លួនរបស់យើងទៅអ្នកជំងឺបន្ទាប់មកទៀតគឺយើងសួរឈ្មោះអ្នកជំងឺតើគាត់ឈ្មោះអី
If the patient is unable to give me their name or unable to respond, I speak in a louder voice, which for me is more difficult because I always talk so loud. And then I might shake them or touch them to see if they respond to that.
បាទអញ្ចឹងប្រសិនបើអ្នកជំងឺនឹងក៏អត់ឆ្លើយតបនៅពេលដែលយើងសួរទេគឺយើងត្រូវសួរគាត់ឲ្យខ្លាំងជាងមុនបាទយើងសួរខ្លាំងជាងមុនបន្ទាប់មកទៀតយើងគោះស្មារបស់គាត់ដើម្បីមើលថាតើគាត់នឹងដឹងខ្លួនឬមួយក៏អត់
If the patient appears ill, then we're going to activate our resources. That may be calling on the doctor or the nurse to help you. And you're going to try to identify someone, a family member or the person that brought the person in to help and provide you a little bit of history and information.
បាទអញ្ចឹងប្រសិនបើអ្នកជំងឺនឹងក៏អត់ឆ្លើយតបជាមួយយើងទេបានថាគាត់ឈឺធ្ងន់គឺអ្វីដែលយើងត្រូវធ្វើគឺរៀបចំធនធានដែលយើងមានបាទហើយតកតមកទុនធាននឹងគឺមានសម្ភារៈហើយនឹងបុគ្គលិកផ្សេងផ្សេងទៀតដែលត្រូវការដើម្បីជួយយើងនេះហើយនឹងយើងសួរប្រវត្តិជំងឺពីអ្នកដែលនាំជំងឺនឹងមក
So things that we are going to look for on their general appearance does the person look chronically ill are they wasted appearing and then we're going to look for signs of things like anxiety sleepiness sweatiness or whether they are breathing hard and look like they are becoming tired and unable to breathe.
បាទអញ្ចឹងតកតុងមួយសភាពទូទៅនឹងគឺយើងមើលមើលតើគាត់មើលទៅដូចជាមានជំងឺរ៉ាំរ៉ៃក៏អត់បើមិនជាគាត់មកមើលទៅជាស្គមហើយមានបញ្ហាបាទហើយបន្តមកទៀតយើងមើលមើលតើសភាពរបស់គាត់នឹងគាត់លេះឡាស់ណាគាត់សន្លឹមឬមួយក៏គាត់មានការដកដង្ហើមខ្សោយដោយសារគាត់ប្រឹងយូរទៅគាត់ដកលែងរួចឬមួយក៏គាត់មានបញ្ហាមកបែកញើសស្អិត
And then as we assess the level of consciousness, we generally use a simple scale. And the simplest scale that the majority of healthcare providers use is the AVPU, which is alert, are they responding normally? Verbal, are they responding to words or sounds? And are they talking?Pain, are they only responding when you cause the patient pain? And not responsive or unresponsive, where they are not responding to any stimuli.
emergency AVPU AVPU នឹងគឺអេបានថាអ្នកជំងឺគាត់ដឹងខ្លួនធម្មតាគាត់និយាយគាត់តបមួយយើងធម្មតាបាទវីបានថាឆ្លើយតបទៅនឹងសម្លេងបាទគាត់អាចបិទភ្នែកបើអីទៅពេលយើងនិយាយទៅបាទគាត់ឆ្លើយមួយយើងវិញភីនឹងគឺគាត់ឆ្លើយតបនៅពេលដែលយើងធ្វើឲ្យឈឺសួរមិនក៏អត់ឆ្លើយដែរបាទថាសេចក្តីអីនឹងគាត់អាចនឹងលើកដៃលើកជើងហើយយូគឺ
So then we move on to the airway. And the easiest way to assess the airway is to see if the patient was speaking. If they are speaking, their airway is almost always okay.
បាទបន្តមកទៀតយើងធ្វើការវាតម្លៃពីផ្លូវខ្យល់របស់អ្នកជំងឺអញ្ចឹងជាការងាយស្រួលបើសិនជាអ្នកជំងឺនឹងគាត់និយាយជាមួយយើងបានគាត់ឆ្លើយជាមួយយើងបានបានន័យថាផ្លូវខ្យល់របស់គាត់នឹងគឺអត់មានបញ្ហាអីទេ
If they're not speaking, then you're going to have to check to see if the airway is obstructed, blocked, or not protected.
And
during this course, we'll talk about then what you can do to either help that airway by protecting it or assisting the patient.
បាទអញ្ចឹងក្នុងវគ្គរបស់យើងនេះយើងនឹងបង្រៀនថាតើមានវិធីណាខ្លះដើម្បីជួយការពារផ្លូវដង្ហើមរបស់អ្នកជំងឺហ្នឹង
So what would you look for if you were concerned that the patient may have an obstructed airway or not protected airway? The things that you should be doing are listening for stridor or snoring and also looking for secretions or vomit in the back of the throat, and then also whether they have a gag reflex.
បាទអញ្ចឹងអ្វីដែលយើងរមើសម្រាប់អ្នកជំងឺដែលមានបញ្ហាក្នុងការដកដង្ហើមហ្នឹងគឺផ្លូវដង្ហើមរបស់គាត់តើគាត់មានបញ្ហាស្ទះឬមួយក៏អត់ថាគាត់អាចការពារផ្លូវខ្យល់របស់គាត់បានឬក៏អត់អញ្ចឹងតាមរយៈការស្ដាប់រោគឺយើងស្ដាប់រមើតើគាត់មានឮសម្លេងដូចជាស្រែកដរឬក៏សម្លេងដូចជាសមុកឬទេហើយយើងមើលមើលតើគាត់មានការឡើងស្លេះ
Now, there's a couple of things about checking a gag reflex. One, never use your finger, because you might lose your finger.
The
other thing that I hear sometimes is, well, what if they vomit when I check the gag reflex? So I don't want to make things worse. If they are vomiting with a gag reflex and not protecting their airway, you should be ready to suction it if necessary. But if that patient is not protecting their airway, you need to know that. And so that is more important, okay? You just have to be prepared.
So
this is a patient in distress, yes? So this patient has stridor and does not have an airway that is okay. This is an impending emergency.
បាទអញ្ចឹងវីដេអូនេះគឺបង្ហាញពីអ្នកជំងឺដែលមានបញ្ហាក្នុងការដកដង្ហើមហ្នឹងគឺគាត់មានបញ្ហាគឺយើងឮសម្លេងស្រែកដោហើយបាទហើយយើងឃើញថាសម្លេងស្រែកដោហ្នឹងប្រាប់យើងថាគាត់មានបញ្ហាតាក់ទងនឹងផ្លូវដង្ហើមខាងលើរបស់គាត់
After we've checked the airway, we go on to B or breathing. And a good way to evaluate that is if the patient can speak in full sentences. If they are breathing so fast that they can only say a few words, you know that they are not going to be able to keep that up for too long. They will get tired. And if the breathing is a problem, you're going to consider putting them on oxygen. And if it is very bad, bag mask ventilation. So what are the signs of respiratory distress? Well, oftentimes you're able to just tell by looking at them, especially if you've taken their shirt off. But things you should look for is the breathing fast? But also look if the breathing is very slow. You should look at the depth of the breathing. Is it very shallow? Look at the effort. Like our previous patient, are they having lots of needing to use accessory muscles and all their whole body to breathe? And then finally, you're going to listen to the patient. So, is this patient in respiratory distress? This patient, respiratory distress. What do you think? If you look at the monitor, what is the rate on the monitor? It's the bottom number. So this patient's oxygen saturation is okay, but this is an adult, elderly man. He's breathing 50 times, 48 times in 1 minute. He will not be able to do that for very long. After we finish B, we move on to C, or circulation. I like to start with a peripheral pulse, either a radial pulse for an adult or a brachial pulse for a child. And then if the radial or brachial pulse is not present or I can't feel it, I feel for a central pulse, either the carotid or the femoral.
Ba chang tae tong muay ka vi damlai chalana chiem rot keu chi tu tau keu jeung thveu doy sa ka chap chip chaw hai dambong lan keu jeung chap chip chaw peripheral do chi chip chaw radial chi phsae chpu mneu chas hai kong khmey jeung aich phrae chip chaw
Now, if the central pulse is weak or absent, then we're going to do something to support the circulation. Obviously, if it's absent, we start CPR. If it is just weak, we might consider fluids and putting the patient on a cardiac monitor. Vital signs. Vital means important. They're called vital signs for a reason.
បាទអញ្ចឹងសញ្ញាជីវិតហើយគាត់ពន្យល់ពីអង់គ្លេសនេះ vital ហ្នឹងមានន័យថាសំខាន់អញ្ចឹង vital sign គឺសញ្ញាដែលសំខាន់បំផុត
So we don't fill out the vital signs on our patient for tomorrow today just because it is easier
បាទអញ្ចឹងតើតើមួយ vital sign ហ្នឹងគឺយើងមិនអាចបំពេញ vital sign អ្នកជំងឺសម្រាប់ថ្ងៃស្អែកយើងយកថ្ងៃនេះបំពេញទុកថ្ងៃស្អែកបានទេព្រោះ vital sign គឺមានសារៈសំខាន់ណាស់
So in the emergency setting, after we've done our initial evaluation and interventions, then we're going to collect vital signs. We want to get them early and we want to get all of them.
បានចឹងតកតងមួយករណីសង្គ្រោះបន្ទាន់ក្រោយពីយើងធ្វើការវិដំឡៃដំបងរួចហើយគឺយើងចាប់ផ្ដើមជោគសញ្ញាជីវិតរបស់គាត់គឺយើងយកទាំងអស់ព្រោះសញ្ញាជីវិតទាំងអស់គឺសំខាន់
And it's important to remember that if you need a chart to remember all of the normal vital signs for a child, I think it is impossible to remember all of these numbers, so you should have this either in your pocket or posted on the wall of your hospital.
បាទយើងតកតងជាមួយនឹងសញ្ញាជីវិតធម្មតាជាពិសេសនៅលើកុមារគឺមានការពិបាកព្រោះវាប្រែប្រួលទៅតាមអាយុកាលហើយយើងមិនអាចចាំបានទាំងអស់ទេអញ្ចឹងវិធីដែលល្អគឺយើងគួរតែមានសញ្ញាជីវិតឆាតមួយដែលបញ្ជាក់ពីសញ្ញាជីវិតធម្មតាតាមអាយុកាលនៅក្នុងកប៉ៅរបស់យើងឬមួយក៏បិទនៅកន្លែងដែលយើងធ្វើការ
And remember, do not ignore abnormal vital signs. That is one of the most common errors that I see in the United States and other places as well.
បាទអញ្ចឹងអ្វីដែលសំខាន់តកតមួយសញ្ញាជីវិតហ្នឹងគឺប្រសិនបើយើងឃើញសញ្ញាជីវិតមិនធម្មតាយើងមិនត្រូវបំភ្លេចវាចោលទេគឺសញ្ញាជីវិតមិនធម្មតាគឺមានបញ្ហាយើងត្រូវចងចាំ
If after your initial evaluation or during it you find the patient sick, remember to think about an IV and putting the patient on oxygen and if available, if you have it, a monitor.
បើអញ្ចឹងបើសិនជាក្នុងការវាតម្លៃដំបងយើងគិតថាអ្នកជំងឺគាត់ធ្ងន់ធ្ងរគាត់មានបញ្ហាគឺយើងត្រូវចាក់រងគាត់មានអាហារដាក់អុកស៊ីហ្សែនឲ្យគាត់ហើយបើសិនជាកន្លែងយើងមានការចាក់ monitor នោះគឺយើងភ្ជាប់ទៅជាមួយនឹង monitor ហើយ
Now we need to do things quickly in the emergency department in the emergency setting and that doesn't mean we don't want to connect with our patient because the more the patient trusts us the better care that we will be able to provide
បាទទោះបីជាក្នុងលក្ខណៈ emergency យើងត្រូវធ្វើការងារច្រើនហើយបន្ទាន់ក៏ដោយក៏យើងត្រូវចាំថាយើងត្រូវការតាក់ទងជាមួយនឹងអ្នកជំងឺព្រោះកាលណាយើងតាក់ទងជាមួយនឹងអ្នកជំងឺគាត់ទុកចិត្តយើងជាងគាត់ឲ្យព័ត៌មានច្រើនដល់យើងសម្រាប់ជួយគាត
់ So contrary or against what some people would say in that in the emergency you don't need to connect or have a relationship with your patient I would say that somebody working in the emergency department needs to be able to do this better than everybody else because you have to connect and form that relationship very quickly.
បាទអញ្ចឹងមានមតិខ្លះគេនិយាយថាក្នុង emergency ហ្នឹងមិនបាច់ចាំតាក់ទងមួយអ្នកជំងឺច្រើនពេកទេព្រោះគាត់ធ្ងន់ហើយបាទអញ្ចឹងគាត់គាត់បញ្ជាក់ថាតាក់ទងជាមួយ emergency គឺគ្រូពេទ្យដែលនៅ emergency ត្រូវតាក់ទងជាមួយអ្នកជំងឺឲ្យបានល្អជាងគ្រូពេទ្យនៅកន្លែងផ្សេងទៀតព្រោះកាលណាអ្នកជំងឺគាត់ទុកចិត្តយើងការព្យាបាលគឺបានល្អហើយបានស្រួលជាងមុន
So how we do that? We do things like introducing yourself, getting low, look at the patient, sit down or bend down so they don't have to look up at you from the bed and you're standing over them. Tell them what you think is happening. Tell them what to expect. Touch their hand if appropriate.To reassure them.
បាទអញ្ចឹងអ្វីដែលយើងគួរធ្វើគឺទី1យើងណែនាំខ្លួនរបស់យើងទៅអ្នកជំងឺហើយមួយទៀតយើងគួរតែអង្គុយឲ្យស្មើនឹងគាត់ណាយើងមិនគួរឈរឲ្យដើម្បីគាត់ងើយមើលយើងទេយើងអាចនឹងលុតជង្គង់ឬមិនអង្គុយចោះដើម្បីកម្រិតនៃការមើលគឺស្មើគ្នាហើយយើងអាចនឹងស្ទាបដៃរបស់គាត់ដើម្បីបង្កើតភាពស្និទ្ធស្នាលហើយយើងប្រាប់គាត់ថាអ្វីដែលនឹងកើតឡើងអ្វីដែលយើងនឹងធ្វើចំពោះគាត់តាក់ទងជាមួយនឹងការពិនិត្យជំងឺរបស់យើង
So then our evaluation, remember, in the unstable patient, we are going to do the evaluate the patient, think about the possible causes and our actions or interventions at the same time, meaning we might be getting the history while examining the patient while someone else is placing an IV and giving fluids. Then we're going to reevaluate them after our initial treatment to see if they're improving or getting worse. And then we think about further treatment and where they need to go.
Và chúng ta tôn chỉ muốn rằng nét chữ ngữ để ngôn châu mọi mờn si hay dùng mơ ta sẽ phía bảo quản mình là ổ. Chính giờ chăm chấm hiên bảo dưỡng cứ tìm mối cứ dương vi đầm lấy. Tạo mọi dương kết ta ai màu bị bảnh hà sấy hay dương thư vô cao chia bá không phê chỉ mùi cái này. Hãy tạo bị dương thư vô ở ổn tả công chia bá quát hái dương thư vi đầm lấy quát làng vĩnh. Dương kết đá tha ta miên bảnh hà sấy cả láng hay nông to cao chia bá bảo quát điệt. Một lần dương thư vô cao chia bá trong cõi tha ta dương quát cô ta nơi cả lại nhìn mờn xì si nó được có trời chung ta cả lại nạp xên tiết là mấy chị ba bằng to.
Now if after your initial evaluation the patient appears stable and you didn't find any abnormalities that are concerning, you can use a more traditional approach to evaluating them where you take a full history and then do a full physical exam before you start doing interventions. But that's why you do the initial evaluation to tell whether you're dealing with the unstable or the stable patient.
បាទអញ្ចឹងប្រសិនបើក្រោយការវាតម្លៃដំបូងយើងឃើញថាអ្នកជំងឺនឹងក៏អត់មានបញ្ហាអីទេអញ្ចឹងយើងអាចប្រើវិធីព្យាបាលដែលយើងធ្លាប់ធ្វើពីមុនហ្នឹងគឺជាការសួរប្រវត្តិគាត់ឲ្យបានដិតដល់ណាការពិនិត្យរាងកាយឲ្យគ្រប់ទីកន្លែងហើយនឹងការព្យាបាលបន្តអ្វីដែលយើងគួរធ្វើចំពោះគាត
់ For history in English, we like to use the mnemonic sample, which stands for symptoms, allergies, medications, past medical history, when they ate last, and then what happened to bring them to the hospital.
បាទយើងតកតោជាមួយនឹងការសួរជំងឺនៅក្នុង emergency គឺភាសាអង់គ្លេសវាមានការងាយស្រួលជាងយើងគឺគេច្រើនប្រើពាក្យថា sample ហើយខ្មែរយើងអត់មានពាក្យកាត់ទេពិបាកបន្តិចចឹង sample ហ្នឹងគឺសំដៅទៅលើ S ហ្នឹងគឺរោគសញ្ញាតែអ្នកជំងឺគាត់មានសញ្ញាស្អីខ្លះ A ហ្នឹងគឺ allergy គាត់មានបញ្ហាប្រតិកម្មស្អីគេហើយថ្នាំអ្វីដែលគាត់ប្រើសម្រាប់អសរ M P ហ្នឹងតកតងប្រវត្តិជំងឺពីមុនមករបស់គាត់ L ហ្នឹងគឺពេលវេលាដែលគាត់បរិភោគអាហារចុងក្រោយហើយ E ហ្នឹងគឺមូលហេតុណាដែលបណ្ដាលឲ្យគាត់មកមន្ទីរពេទ្យហ្នឹង
So with the symptoms, most of us are good at getting a description of the symptoms, when it started, how bad it is, how long it has been going on.
បាទយើងតាក់ទងជាមួយរោគសញ្ញាគឺភាគច្រើនគឺយើងចេះរបៀបសួរគឺយើងសួរបានល្អតាក់ទងជាមួយជំងឺនៅ emergency ហ្នឹងយើងសួរថាតើវាកើតឡើងនៅពេលណាកើតឡើងរយៈពេលប្រមាណហើយកើតឡើងរបៀបម៉េចហើយឈឺធ្ងន់កម្រិតណា
A helpful way to remember that is to remember O, P, Q, R, S, T, and we add U for unifying symptoms, which means things that help bring the information together to help a diagnosis.
បាទអញ្ចឹងភាសាអង់គ្លេសមានការងាយស្រួលដែរគឺគេចាំពាក្យ O, P, Q, R, S, T ហើយគេថែម U ចុងក្រោយគឺរោគសញ្ញារួមផ្សំផ្សេងៗទៀតដើម្បីធ្វើឲ្យយើងងាយស្រួលក្នុងការធ្វើរោគវិនិច្ឆ័យអ្នកជំងឺ
For example, if a patient comes to you, an elderly female with back pain, one thing you might ask them is, do they have a fever? Because that might suggest a unifying symptom in something like pyelonephritis or a kidney infection.
បាទចុះឧទាហរណ៍ដូចជាអ្នកជំងឺចាស់ម្នាក់គាត់មកដោយសារឈឺខ្នងអញ្ចឹងយើងអាចសួរគាត់បន្ថែមថាគាត់មានក្តៅខ្លួនឬអត់អានេះគឺជាសញ្ញារួមផ្សំផ្សេងទៀតដើម្បីឲ្យយើងគិតថាបើសិនជាគាត់មានក្តៅខ្លួនក៏អាចមានបញ្ហាមកពីរលាកតម្រងនោមបាទ
And then we come up with how do we develop an emergency differential diagnosis? Well, it's somewhat similar to the traditional approach, but there's a little bit of differences.
បាទអញ្ចឹងតកតងជាមួយនឹងការធ្វើរោគវិនិច្ឆ័យញែកនៅក្នុង emergency ហ្នឹងគឺភាគច្រើនគឺវាស្រដៀងគ្នាជាមួយនឹងការធ្វើរោគវិនិច្ឆ័យញែកនៅក្នុងការព្យាបាលជំងឺផ្សេងៗទៀតដែរ
One thing I remember is that I don't think of very unusual or uncommon things. I first think of the things that are most common. So if you come with a cough, I don't say, oh, it must be hantavirus. Then we also think about the things that are the most concerning or the worst things it could be. Right? So we want to think about the things that are life-threatening or could kill the patient. So if a patient comes to you with a cough and you say, well, I don't know what it is, and it turns out to be a cold, a common cold, and you miss it, it's probably not going to harm the patient. But if it is a patient who has pneumonia and shock from that and you miss it, then the patient could do very badly. So we like to think about the worst things early on also. We're going to reevaluate our patient as we get more information or we give them treatment to see how they respond. And then a very important point and one of the keys to emergency medicine is that you don't have to make up a diagnosis because you don't know what it is. Right? Having a differential diagnosis that includes it but not knowing exactly what it is okay. So what are some of the challenges of the emergency medicine approach? Things to watch out for. One is that it's a new method, so sometimes it feels uncomfortable. The other thing is that, you know, sometimes we really want to get all the information first, and that might stop you from intervening early, but that's a critical component of practicing emergency medicine. And then you want to avoid common emergency medicine pitfalls or problems. And some of these common problems are not rechecking the patient, not recognizing abnormal vital signs, not listening to the patient, and then finally, not narrowing or reducing things on your differential diagnosis. But the benefits of this approach are large, and if you do them, okay, you can save a lot of lives. Another benefit that we heard a bit about this morning was the cost. Healthcare is expensive in every country, and emergency medicine or practicing this approach is not expensive. It's low cost and it's simple. And then finally, it's unique. It makes you special because you have a way of caring for patients in the emergency setting that other people are not trained to do.
But the purpose of this treatment is to improve the quality of life and
So in summary, remember that you're going to evaluate, think, and act at the same time when the patient is sick. You're going to use a systematic approach and do it 10,000 times. And you're going to recheck your patient. So I want to thank you, and I want to give a special thank you to Dr. Chheng for all his excellent, what I assume is an excellent interpretation. Any questions for us?
បាទអញ្ចឹងលោកគ្រូអ្នកគ្រូមានសំណួរអត់អាចសួរមកបាន